Welcome to this virtual open house for Jenny Perlin, who's been artist in residence for the month of January. Before we get started, I just wanted to acknowledge that Boxo Projects is located on the traditional lands of the Chimaweve, Serrano, and Kuwia people. And I'd like to invite you, wherever you are, to consider the Indigenous people who've stewarded the land where you are. So welcome, as I said, to this virtual open house. I'm Bernard Liebov, director at Boxo Projects, for those of you whom I have not met. Also here today from Boxo, at least that I can see so far, are Amy Bouye, who's our programs coordinator, Stephen Bella, and Danielle Cornell, who are on the executive committee, and I believe Julie Wyman, who is an advisory committee member, is on as well. One of the key aspects of the Boxo Project's residency is that artists are asked to devise projects, and projects related to, very much related to this place in some way. And the key reason that we do that is in order to be able to introduce artists to local subject experts and work, you know, get them to work together. The Joshua Tree community, or the Morongo Basin community, is so rich in subject and cultural experts of all sorts. It's a real pleasure to be able to have them work with artists and form these relationships. So during her time here, even before her time here, Jenny has been working with a local organization called Sky's the Limit, and we're very grateful to them. It's a local observatory and astronomy organization. And Anne Congdon from Sky's the Limit is here to say a few words. So I'd like to turn it over to Anne.
Well, thank you. I appreciate this opportunity to introduce Sky's the Limit. We're an all-volunteer nonprofit, and our mission is to provide hands-on learning about the desert, earth, and sky. Now, the small group of volunteers who envisioned an observatory and nature center in 29 Palms way back in 2004 saw the opportunity for hands-on educational experiences at the nexus of art and science. And from the very beginning, art and design played an important role in the development of our programs, as well as in the creation of our physical campus. Many of our volunteers in astronomy and the natural sciences are in their professional lives artists as well. We have musicians, poets, actors, architects, and sculptors. So it was exciting and totally consistent with our mission to connect with Jenny for her exploration of the sun. We were very happy to loan her a telescope and provide some guidance on how to observe and document safely. And of course, Jenny's warm personality and enthusiasm were bright spots in these difficult times. So we're very pleased to have had a small part, that it was a fruitful collaboration, and we look forward to Jenny's presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. And you know, we're eternally grateful for everything that you've done and the generosity that you've shown Jenny and Boxo. One small bit of housekeeping that I missed earlier was that we are recording the session, so for anybody to whom that matters in some way, if you want to come off video or do whatever, please just know that that's happening. I'm sure you'll have some questions for Jenny. Please feel free to put them in the chat box as they occur to you, and we will admit them, as they say, as this process is going right now, at the end of Jenny's presentation. But it's a great pleasure to introduce Jenny to you. I've known Jenny for many years. We've crisscrossed at art events in New York, and it's been a long time in the works to have her come and do a residency here. The COVID situation has upended a lot of our programming and residencies, but in a funny way facilitated Jenny's coming, because she's ordinarily based in New York, but owing to some COVID circumstances and some luck, has been in LA for the past, or is in LA for a year. And so was able to come and do the first live residency since we suspended programming. So Jenny is a filmmaker. She makes films and videos, installations and drawings. She also makes animations from those drawings, and she's going to share one of those with us today. Her projects involve deep research into cultural phenomenon of various sorts. And again, she will share the big project that she's working on right now, which is a very interesting cultural phenomenon in and of itself, and the films that she's making in relation to that. She did her undergraduate at Brown, her MFA at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. And she's also a graduate of the Whitney Independent Study. But mostly I'm just very grateful she was able to make it and would like to turn it over to Jenny now to tell us about her time here and her project.
Hi, thank you so much for having me here. What I'm going to do today is kind of do a little bit of a backwards presentation. I will start with the film that I made while here in residence. It's called Sunspots. And then I thought it might be fun to kind of break it down and sort of show you what the process was of creating that film and where some of the ideas and images came from. So let me see what's happening in the world of PowerPoint and videos. But so I'm going to start with this 6.5 minute film called Sunspots that I made here with the help of Sky's the Limit and of course with Voxo Project's warmth and support.
Thank you.
Hi, I hope that you were all able to hear that okay. I was just a little bit nervous about that as it was going on. But that's the film that I had the pleasure and privilege of making here at BOXO Project. I'm gonna share the screen again and sort of go backwards through some of the images that you saw in the film and tell you a little bit about from whence they came. More sharing of screens. Okay. So this film is called Sunspots. It's HD, color and black and white, sound, 6 minutes, 25 seconds, 2021. I did not know that I would be making this particular film here, but I'd like to just go through a little bit what's inside the making of a film like Sunspots, because they go pretty fast and we can sort of backtrack. If there's time, we'll talk about what's behind the making of this project, and there's many more experimental animations where that came from. But first, of course, acknowledging my gratitude to Sky's the Limit and BOXO Project for having me here and for teaching me how to look at sunspots and lending me the telescope. So when making a film that is both abstract and is trying to tell a little bit of a story, it often helps me to go back to historical sources. And I had made a number of drawings of sunspots over the years, going back and forth between the spots first recorded by Christoph Scheiner in 1611. And you can see some of the images, his sunspots in the film. And this is an image of his solar scope from the period. These are images that Galileo Galilei drew and published in 1613. And those images, there's 36 of them. I copied all of those as animations, stop motion animations, also in the film Sunspots. And these two astronomers didn't start out as rivals, but became bitter enemies when Galileo laid claim to having seen and published about sunspots first, and Scheiner had not wanted that that information made public. The other thing, the difference between Scheiner and Galileo, of course, was that Scheiner was a devout Jesuit and believed initially that sunspots were not actually on the sun, because the sun was considered to be a divine and it could have no flaws. And Galileo quite correctly said, actually, the spots are on the sun and there's nothing you can do about it. So that is also in the film, where you see that Scheiner is saying the sun is divine, it's clear, it's spotless, and Galileo is saying, no, it's not. I will say later on, of course, Scheiner was like, actually, Galileo was right, but for the purposes of this short film, that seemed a little complicated. Here are some images of the sunspot projections using the that you saw in the film, using the telescope from Sky's the Limit. Needless to say, I innocently came to Sky's the Limit crowing about how I was going to draw sunspots and, you know, project them inside this cardboard box, etc. And I had not necessarily done all my homework and not realized that this is actually the low sunspot season. So this is the lowest point in the sunspot cycle. Therefore, there really are no sunspots to be seen. But as an artist does, we just kind of forge on and continue. So I began taking photographs every 30 minutes of a projection of the sun. And here's another one. Very beautiful, very spotless. Moving on through the film, you see images of this little guy, and this little guy. These are monoprints that I made in the fall in anticipation of coming to Boxo Projects. Two of these creatures are to be found here in the Joshua Tree Morongo Valley area, the gamble squail, as you know, and the harvester ant. And I was very devoted to all of these creatures. This is a desert grasshopper that you don't really find here, but it served purposes that I'll get to in a minute. But I felt connected to creatures who stay close to the ground, who scuttle around and hide under bushes, and who sort of sequester themselves in safe spaces. And we'll come to that as well in a little bit. This is an image of part of the series of monoprints of a steel door in the desert floor in Landers, out in Landers near Great Rock. And in the fall, I had seen a real estate listing for this piece of land with the steel door in it. Underneath the steel door is a large room made of cinder blocks, and the real estate was going for, you know, they were asking like around $50,000 for it. I became very excited by this space, and actually in July drove out here to have a look at it. It sort of became a space where I could project all kinds of ideas. What was the space being used for in the past? What could it potentially become. And so I made quite a number of monoprints that you also see in the Sunspots film. So why all this stuff close to the ground? Why these spaces with big steel doors on them in a film about sunspots? To continue backtracking, I'm going to show you a couple of excerpts from two films from a series of five that I've been working on for the past couple of years. These are short documentary films, and they comprise a series called The Bunker Films. And my experiences making these films are part of the reason that I made the film Sunspots. So in 2018, I began traveling to places in the American Midwest where people were living in underground spaces, primarily decommissioned missile silos or munitions bunkers, and interviewing them, staying with them, and kind of getting a sense of why they might have made some of the choices that they did to go and live off-grid, underground, and sort of in anticipation of a number of different potential scenarios that they envisioned coming in the future. Some of those scenarios were things like flooding from climate change. Some of them were, concerns about, nuclear war, and some of them were astronomical concerns like solar flares, meteor impacts, and so forth. So I made two films that are portraits of people. One is called Ed of Subterra, and one is called Milton of Vivos, and three films about businesses that are currently doing extremely well in offering underground shelter or building new shelters for people to buy and put underground wherever they want. So I will show you just a couple stills really quickly from the films. This is from Ed of Subterra. This is Subterra Castle in Kansas. Here's Ed going to get firewood. Here's Ed talking to me about things. This is Milton. He has moved to Vivos, which is a site that has 575 former munitions bunkers in South Dakota, and he has purchased one of them to live in. Here he is at home. This location is in Texas. It's a company called Rising S. This is Gary Lynch, who's one of the proprietors, and they build new steel bunkers that look like this. This one is in Michigan. And is had just been completed, and they're very expensive. This is Fortitude Ranch in West Virginia, and this is one of their shelter spaces. Fortitude Ranch is kind of like the McDonald's of bunkers and shelters. They envision a whole chain, like a whole network across the country. So currently they have a Fortitude in Colorado, Nevada, Texas. I think they're planning one for Michigan, and then this is the one in West Virginia. That's Stephen, who is the COO of West Virginia. And this is the one that the film that I'm currently completing, the last one in the series. This is Survival Condo, also in Kansas. Larry Hall, the developer, actually bought this missile silo from Ed, who is a realtor for silos, and constructed a high-end space for the 1% to come in case of any kind of situation. People are allowed to live there year-round in their condos. Condos look like this with LED TV screens showing what it looks like outside, even though you're 150 feet underground. And I'll show you two short excerpts from two of the bunker films that give you a sense of what I took from that to put into the Sunspots film. Let me just get organized. Okay, I will skip some of this. Okay, Ed closes me into a bunker and we laugh about it briefly. But now I'll just start with the true beginning of the film.
Okay, I'll tell you this other thing. There's a drink that's got some powders in it.
Mm-hmm.
Healthy. Yeah. Yeah, how much do you trust me not to poison you?
I'm not sure yet.
May I tell you, I would in no way ever harm you.
Thank you.
Trust me. Thank and you may trust
I
me.
Do.
And
I do.
And the more you trust me, the more it places responsibility on me to always honor that very carefully.
So okay. I'll follow you.
Okay. Yeah. I've been to film so many times in the tunnel. Just walking makes me feel better.
Yeah.
Chicken Little and the Sky is Falling is interesting, and you know, especially, and then the Three Little Pigs, you know, I think we are the fourth pig. We're not in the brick house, we're the fourth pig. And the Ant and the Grasshopper, I really like that. I like that. The ant, and I can relate to the ant that stores and that's underground and it's busy and bringing in things to store up for the winter. Like, I have lots of wood that I go out there and find, bring it in. I'm very warm all winter. Nolan has not stored any wood. He's cold. He let all the pipes in the cabin freeze. Boy, I don't know what I'm going to do with that. You know, he's really not treated the cabin well. He's got these three big dogs that are in there a lot of times when he's gone. It's like, okay, well, he's like a grasshopper. And when it gets cold and when it gets difficult, he comes here to shower and he comes here to be, well, I have some wood that he'll never freeze down there. But so the ant is one who prepares and one who is very organized. Well, the grasshopper fiddles away the summer, dances and fiddles and plays and makes no preparation for the time that's coming and then dies as the cold comes.
So, Ed is telling me that the story of the ant and the grasshopper. I had spent 4 days staying in Ed's missile silo, which is a kind of new age paradise. And I asked him, what his favorite children's stories were. And so this Ant and the Grasshopper, which is a story, it's an Aesop's fable, really, really struck me because, of course, Ed considers himself the ant that's gathering everything. And I'm fascinated by that, you know. So when making the Sunspots film, I thought, I better put that in there. And having done that and sort of told it the way Ed told it, I thought, well, that's totally depressing. And actually, that's not at all what I want to say. I really want to say, like, it's kind of better to sing and, like be creative and not just hide out underground and explore the world and, like, find pleasure in your surroundings. So in the end of the Little Sunspots film, I tried to sort of change the structure and have it end with more of a positive note about being out in the world and singing a little bit rather than staying huddled underground and, hiding away from everything. I'll show you, if you'll grant me, one more clip where Milton is discussing some of his concerns about the sun. I hope this works. Let's see. Here you are, Milton.
Bet you think I'm sitting at home? No. Bet you think that I'm all alone? No. Bet you think I'm missing you and wishing you would call my phone? Hell no. I went wheels up on the runway. That ticket was a long way. I'm somewhere on the beach, sipping something strong. Got a new girl, she got it going on. We drink all day and party all night. I'm way too gone to have you on my mind. But she got a body, and she's naughty. And she got me like you ain't ever got me. I'm getting some, and I ain't.
Well, guys, I'll be putting milk in here. You know who it is. Check it out. Alright, time to put milk in. We'll go up this hill, show you guys this beautiful day we have going. Check it out. Incredible first day, guys, of the rest of my life. Just wanted to show you guys a little bit. What's going on? Made it here safely. Evo. What's up? Just wanted to say I'm here. I'm good. XS is coming along very well. Super, super fun. Super excited. I got my first interview. I really would like to interview her.
So, yes. I do believe that this next binary, what, even if it's whatever it's out there, I don't even know anymore if it's even real. I really don't. Because I think from 2012 to 2018, we should have seen another sun. I don't, you know, something. I just haven't seen. So right there, I just, even though you have all these videos that you have out there of second suns and things you don't look, and they're legit videos. So what is it? You know, you don't know. There's something brewing. Just because I didn't see it with my own two eyes doesn't mean it doesn't exist. It just means that I haven't seen it.
So, yeah, I hope that you were able to hear that one. But Milton is talking about how, you know, he was very devoted to a particular online YouTube presence who predicted the end of the world in 2012. And when that didn't happen, Milton kind of cast about looking for another sort of set of reasons to continue in his belief systems. And then this kind of idea of the double sun appearance and, you know, binary solar systems appearing in our sky as something, but that also didn't come true. So now he's kind of casting about looking for another sort of area to believe in. But so Milton's concerns about solar flares and sunspots, like I mentioned before, are echoed by pretty much everybody that I've met in these bunker situations. And that was a big motivation for wanting to do the project here, even though the film that came out of it is much more joyful than I would say than a lot of the bunker films have sort of turned out to be. And speaking of joyful, I will just show you a little bit, a couple more images from some of the other works that I've created while in residence here, if I can get that working. And after that, just close out with one image that I like to share. So in addition to the films, I created a number of drawings using oil stick on oil-based paper. And what I've done is relatively simple, just created differing aspects of the sun and then broken them apart into four pieces that function both as bits of the sun, but also as abstractions. So there are certain sets in reds, oranges, and yellows that relate to some prior work of mine in those same colors. Here are a couple of process shots of how they were made, you know, just taping these big sheets of paper together, creating the image, and then taking them apart, as you can see on the wall behind me. So these afforded me the opportunity to be physical on a larger scale than when I'm sort of hunched over animating sunspots, sort of one spot at a time. And I tend to go back and forth between these sort of larger scale, more colorful drawing projects and the two different kinds of filmmaking projects that that I've shown you previously. And finally, so I make all of this stuff, drawings, documentaries, animations, installations, and how does all this stuff go together? We're gonna sort of round it out with this picture and a couple that come after that that return me to my nerdy science origins. Obviously, this is a prism and how a prism refracts light. So, you know, for many years, I thought to myself, well, I'm kind of a filmmaker and kind of a visual artist and kind of like science and literature. You know, like, what do I do with all of this? And once I kind of settled on a kind of idea of refraction as a model for art making, I felt like it all made sense. So, you know, thinking about the white light coming through the window shade and the hole as an idea, right? So the idea is like the underground and, you know, what constitutes this space underneath our feet that has a completely different kind of geography and psychology than the sort of spaces above. That's my white sunlight. Then you get to put it through a really cool prism. And once you do that, you have the opportunity as an artist, or I feel that I do, to explore all the different shades in different media and different formats. And as a result, the work, while it may not look of one style from a visual perspective, it all comes back to its source, which is this one idea that's then been refracted. And then just a couple little nerdy things that I really like. I'm quite fond of William Herschel, the astronomer, and Caroline's brother. He discovered the planet Uranus and moons and stars and invented the term asteroid and cataloged thousands of double stars. And in 1800, he discovered infrared rays. Kind of by accident. So he was doing an experiment. His control thermometer, where he was measuring the temperatures of different light rays coming through a prism, his control thermometer kind of went out of control. So it really heated up a lot. And he thought, well, there must be some kind of light ray past the red spectrum, and we just can't see it. So while he didn't necessarily identify it correctly, he was the first to discover some of the invisible light sources, light rays that we now, you know, use in all kinds of technologies. So, you know, I think artists are creatures that are working within sort of the visible light spectrum, but also, you know, we have the pleasure of being able to put so many different aspects of our interests together so that we potentially could also bring something from the invisible spectrum into view. So I think with that, I will stop and really just thank Boxo Project and Sky's the Limit for your kindness, patience, and dedication to allowing the visible and invisible spectrum to emerge. And I'd be more than happy to take questions of any kind. Thank you.
Making sure I'm unmuted. Great. Thank you, Jenny, for pulling the threads together of all the disparate parts of your practice and how they come together. I just wanted to say again, if anybody has any questions, please just put them into the chat box below, or there's a way to virtually raise your hand. So we'll just give a couple of seconds for that. And if not, I'll just thank you all for being here on a Saturday afternoon. Wish you well. Jenny's contact details are on the Boxo site, so you can get hold of her with anything. Look out for those bunker films when they come around. They're really fascinating as well. Also, just wanted to say that Jenny will be having an exhibition at Pomona, I believe, at the Broad Museum at Pomona College in the fall. And we'll send out some information about that as well. So thank you again. Thank you again to Sky's the Limit. Thank you all for being here. And we look forward to seeing you again soon. Cheers.